Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we're going to look at oxidation numbers. Oxidation number tells us the electrons gained or lost if every atom owns its own electrons. Huh? I like to think of oxidation number as the imaginary charge of every atom. This is slightly similar to formal charge, which we covered in organic chemistry.
And this will help us later when we're trying to figure out if an atom got oxidized or reduced.
Say you have NaCl. It's a salt, it appears neutral, but we know that this is an ionic compound that breaks up to give us the sodium positive ion and the chlorine negative ion. What about NaOH? This breaks up to give us Na plus and OH minus. The negative is assumed over the entire hydroxide. To find out where the negative comes from, we can use the formal charge shortcut should minus has that I teach in the tutorial link below to see that hydrogen should have one, has one attached, no formal charge, but oxygen should have six, has seven attached for a formal charge of minus one. That's the source of a negative charge. But what if it's less obvious? What if you're asked to find the oxidation number of every atom in methane or water? How do we figure it out? There's no standard set of rules. As long as you have the concepts and know how to attack the atoms, you'll be okay. But here are the rules I like to follow. An atom in its standard state, or a standalone atom, will have an oxidation number of zero. Monoatomic ions will have an oxidation number that is equal to their charge. The sum of the oxidation number in neutral molecules will add up to zero. The sum of oxidation numbers in polyatomic ions will equal to the charge. Within these rules, we have additional rules for individual atoms, so let's go through some examples and learn the rules as we go. For the first rule, the standard state elements have an oxidation number of zero, and that's because they have a charge of zero. For example, sodium metal, which doesn't have a charge, has an imaginary charge of zero, or not very imaginary, because we can clearly see it has no charge. If I have H2 gas, we have two hydrogen atoms in their standard state. Each hydrogen has an oxidation number of zero, which gives us the total charge of this molecule, zero. Say you're given a carbon compound. You don't know how many carbons there are, but no charges are given. That means each carbon has an oxidation number of zero. Rule number two is very similar in that oxidation numbers don't have to be imaginary if we can see the charge. If I give you the sodium cation, Na+, the charge on sodium is plus one. That means the oxidation number is also equal to plus one. The magnesium ion, Mg2+, has an oxidation number of plus two. The chloride anion, Cl-, has a charge of negative one, therefore an oxidation number of minus one. Let's tackle three and four together, because even though the sum of the charges is zero for neutral or a number for an ion, the way we approach this is going to be the same. And the first thing we want to do is know what to look for on the periodic table when trying to understand the oxidation numbers or the imaginary charges on the atoms. Some simple rules for the periodic table. Group one metals, if part of a larger compound, are going to have an oxidation number of plus one. If we see potassium as an ion, we know it's K+, but if potassium is part of something larger, it still has an oxidation number of plus one. Group two metals, same thing, with an oxidation number of plus two. So magnesium, calcium, strontium, and so on. Jumping over to 7A, the halogens will typically have an oxidation number of minus one, with some exceptions. 6A will typically have an oxidation number of minus two, 5A minus three, and so on. An easy way to remember this is to start on the left and count one, two, then start on the right and see how many spaces you have to go back. Zero, back one for minus one, back two for minus two, back three for minus three, keeping in mind that it's not always the case, because if I have two of these together, for example, nitrogen bound to oxygen, they can't both be negative. So let's see how we determine who gets the charge. But first, for transition metals, Don't memorize any number because they change so much. Instead, look for the clues in the rest of the molecule and solve for the oxidation number of the transition metals. Let's break it down, starting with hydrogen. Notice I said group 1A metals, but not hydrogen, because hydrogen can exist with an oxidation number of +1 or -1, depending on what it's bound to. For example, if I ask you to solve for the oxidation number of hydrogen in HNO3 or in NaH, we're going to get two completely different numbers. When hydrogen is bound to a metal, it gets a -1 oxidation number. If hydrogen is bound to a nonmetal, it has a +1 oxidation number. That means in NaH, hydrogen follows sodium, which is a metal. That means hydrogen should have an oxidation number of -1. And if you break it down, you'll see that we have Na+, H-. Remember rules 3 and 4. The sum of oxidation numbers have to be equal to the sum of the charges or the net charge of the molecule. So Na+ and H- gives us 0. With nitric acid, we have hydrogen bound to a nonmetal. It's bound to a polyatomic ion. So that hydrogen is +1. Nitrate you should recognize as NO3- minus or -1, where once again the sum of the charges equals 0. Another way that you can recognize this is in many cases when hydrogen is at the end, it's negative, but in the beginning, it's positive. But what about the NO3 minus? What is the oxidation number of these individual atoms? Oxygen is typically going to have an oxidation number of -2. And when oxygen is bound to something else, for example, NO3 minus, the other atom will have to adapt to the oxygen. The way to figure this out is to recognize that the charge on the nitrate ion is -1, so the oxidation numbers have to equal to -1. This means we have one nitrogen of unknown oxidation number plus three oxygens of oxidation number -2 that all must equal to -1. That's nitrogen, three oxygens for a charge of -1. Let's simplify. We have nitrogen plus 3 times -2, which is -6, equals -1. Let's isolate the nitrogen, add 6 to both sides, which cancels it out. -6, +6 equals 0. -1 plus 6 is equal to +5. Nitrogen equals +5, which means the oxidation number of nitrogen in nitrate is +5. What about the oxidation number of every atom in carbon dioxide? We know that oxygen should be -2, but what about carbon? Carbon next to oxygen has to adopt to oxygen, so let's solve, setting the sum of oxidation number equal to the charge, which in this case is 0. If no charge is given, if the molecule is neutral, then it has to add up to 0. We have one carbon with an unknown oxidation number, plus two oxygens with an oxidation number of -2, equals 0. Let's simplify. Carbon minus 2 times 2, which is -4, equals 0. Isolate carbon by adding 4 to both sides. -4 plus 4 equals 0. 0 plus 4 is equal to 4. Carbon equals +4, which gives us the oxidation number of carbon and carbon dioxide as +4. Peroxy or peroxides are the one exception to the oxidation number for oxygen. I like to think of peroxy as one peroxy or peroxygen. That means oxygen has a -1 oxidation number instead of -2. The most common peroxides you've seen are H2O2 or the peroxide anion, which is O2 2-. Let's start with the anion. If we look at O2 2-, that means we have two oxygens, and I put the X there so we don't mix it up with a 0. Equals -2. So 2 of the unknown equals -2. Divide by 2, divide by 2. The unknown oxygen is equal to -1. Each oxygen has an oxidation state of -1, and you'll get the same thing when you solve for it in hydrogen peroxide. We mentioned that halogens are typically -1. For example, in HCl, hydrogen bound to a nonmetal would give us an H+ next to a Cl-. But if a halogen is bound to something like an oxygen, the oxygen wins. You should recognize HClO4 as a strong acid to memorize, where we know that this is really an acidic hydrogen, and the ClO4- polyatomic ion. To find the oxidation number of chlorine, we'll set it up the same way. ClO4 is equal to negative 1, where we have chlorine plus 4 times negative 2 for the 4 oxygens equals minus 1. That's chlorine plus 4 times negative 2 is negative 8 equals negative 1. Isolate chlorine by adding 8 to both sides, and that gives us an oxidation number of chlorine is equal to negative 1 plus 8, which is positive 7. Definitely not what you expect when you look at chlorine in group 7A on the periodic table.
Be sure to join me in the next video, where we look at redox pairs and common oxidizing and reducing reagents.
First, make sure to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel so you don't miss when I post new videos. Then visit my website, layerforsci.com/reactions, for the entire MCAT stoichiometry video series along with a practice quiz and cheat sheet.